Hey everybody, what is going on? This is Chris Fitzgerald from Seawolf Studios, and we are looking behind the scenes of a film score MIDI mockup for tonight's webinar. Thank you for joining me. Let's get into it. What we're going to discuss tonight, let me go over the agenda here. We're going to look at virtual instrument libraries and some different ones available to you. We will go over tips for setting up your orchestral MIDI mockup. We will discuss how you deal with instrument articulations and getting phrasing to sound really good for a particular instrument. We'll look at some MIDI editing tips, and we will discuss continuous controllers and track management. When you have an orchestral MIDI mockup, you tend to have a lot of instrument tracks, so we'll talk about some ways to manage those. And then we will also look at key switch and multi-output instruments. So just in a nutshell, the goal with doing an orchestral MIDI mockup is to take your dead, lifeless MIDI instruments and to get them to sound as human and as expressive and as realistic as possible. And that can be very challenging, so that's what we're going to cover tonight. Now, there are a lot of virtual instrument libraries available, and you really need to do your homework before you buy one. There's tons of reviews, there's great articles online going in depth on pros and cons of different virtual instrument libraries. Of course, the probably most important question that you'll need to determine before you purchase a virtual instrument library is what your budget is, and that will certainly either open or close some doors based on how much you have to spend. But virtual instrument libraries range from around $100 to thousands of dollars. Some of the top end stuff, like the full Vienna Symphonic Library that has all the instruments and every single possible articulation that all of those instruments can play and just mapped in a really intuitive way, those libraries can cost a lot of money, but they're recorded in even up to 96 kilohertz and just pristine audio quality. And then you can get something like Garrett & Personal Orchestra for around $129. So if you're new to this stuff and you're just looking for kind of an all-in-one sort of thing to get started with, GPO is a great first investment. It's got all the instruments. They sound great. It's a very good value for what you pay. Contact is by Native Instruments. Native Instruments likes to sneak in K's wherever they can, so you'll notice that all of their instruments have at least one K snuck in there, but it's Contact with two K's. And Contact is kind of the premier sampler. A lot of other libraries use Contact as their base, but Contact itself comes with like a 60 gigabyte library that has all orchestral instruments. It has tons of different rhythm section and band instruments and world instruments and loops and a bunch of cool stuff. So definitely check out Contact. There's also East West, LA Scoring Strings. I'm sure that a lot of you have heard of most of these so far. Vienna Symphonic Library, Project Sam, a few that I left off of here, Big Fish Audio. I bought some stuff from them, and in general, I'm pretty happy with it. The thing that's cool about what they sell is you can get smaller packages. So you can, for example, I got a full string library for some $60 or $70. Now, it's not the best one, but what I like to do when I am mocking up strings is to use different sounds from different libraries. And I find that it thickens it up a little bit. You can kind of take one section sound from one library and another section sound from another library and treat them as if they were different players in that same section. And it just helps thicken things up. Some things to think about: don't discount Reason and Logic and some of your other DAWs or digital audio workstations, because a lot of your DAWs come with sample libraries. And granted, the ones in Reason and Logic are not the best quality, but you have full orchestral instruments available in both of those programs. So This is a big topic. You got to do some research, and it really depends on what you want to do. If you really want to go full bore with this stuff, then I would recommend checking out some of the higher end things. And some of the bigger libraries, I mean, it's broken down to, they have a different up bow and down bow for all the strings and just really extensive. So anyway, these are some of the players in the game, but there's certainly more out there. For tonight's mockup, I did a cue from Pirates of the Caribbean, Dead Man's Chest, which was scored by Hans Zimmer way back in 2006. That seems like a long time ago now. And this cue is called I've Got My Eye on You. So one of those ominous pirate cues. And let me just play it here. So this is the recording from the actual score. Great cue. It's got some really expressive melodies and very rhythmic, and it fits the whole pirate theme very well, I think. It's a great great score for all those Pirates of the Caribbean movies. So, on to the mock-up. Let me show you what I did. Let me get out a Keynote, and actually, before we do that, let me open up the score, the actual score. And I apologize because I did purchase this, but I purchased it and had to print it in order to get a PDF. It was one of those services that they only let you print it once. So what I did was I printed it and then scanned it. So it's not the best quality scan, but it'll do to get the point across. Now, just to take a step back and think about the higher level thing here, doing a mock-up is such a great way to study a score. And so even just for practice, I would recommend that you guys mock stuff up and get some film cues if you can, but even get some symphonic stuff from the classical and romantic eras. Take a look at The Planets by Gustav Holst. That's a great suite to go in and mock up. John Williams has studied that score extensively, so you listen to some of it and it kind of sounds like music from Star Wars, even though it was written back in 1915. But that's because he studied that score very extensively. But that's all good stuff to mock up. And when you mock up some of that stuff, you can kind of get into the brain of a composer. I mean, it's one thing to analyze a score and to study it and to look at it for harmonies and for rhythmic subdivisions and just sort of, you know, phrasing and who's doubling who and all that stuff. But to actually go in and play each part in, you just get such a close view of the score. So anyway, that's my spiel on that. I did from measure 75 to 94, so I really only did 19 measures, and that ended up being about 45 seconds. That's the segment that I played for you guys. So let's take a look at what's going on in this cue. It starts right here. It's in 3/4, and the bass part got cut off down here, but those are eighth notes, not quarter notes. So we've got... the pulse of this piece is in the low strings, which is a very rhythmic ostinato kind of a thing. And the snare is keeping time as well. We've got some timpani rolls, and then the viola and violins come in here with the melody and harmony. The viola harmonizes violin one, and the horns come in here at the same time, so they also are melody and harmony. And after one time through that melody, sorry if this is giving you guys a headache, then the horns come in, trombones and tuba, and they kind of come in on this attack here, and then we go to the swelling theme, and violin one and two split into octaves, and they both take the lead in octaves, and it's this kind of soaring piece. So then we've got trumpet, then when our woodwinds come in, bassoon and bass clarinet. Actually, flute, oboe, and clarinet don't play in this cue at all, but bassoon and bass clarinet do. And so then we've got this soaring melody on the strings here, and then it kind of dies down. So let me open up my mockup. So I put this all together, and I had a good friend mix it, who's a very phenomenally talented mixing engineer. Sota Tsuchiya is his name. I work with him all the time. And he did the mix for me on this. So let me open up. I'm going to do this kind of like a cooking show where I'm going to show the final product, and then I'm going to go back to before all the ingredients were put together. All right, we'll open up the queue. Hopefully it won't take too long. While that's opening, let me kick back over to the score and talk about some of the particular challenges with this score. Anytime you have anything really rhythmic, it's very difficult to not have all of your MIDI instruments sound like machine guns. So getting the cello and bass to play so that they don't sound super repetitive, because the thing is, there's one recording for these notes, and actually in a good sample library, they'll have multiple recordings for different notes, and certainly different recordings at different dynamic levels, but they'll even have multiple recordings at a high dynamic level, like fortissimo, and at a few at mezzo forte, and a few at piano, so that every time you hit the key, it kind of like cycles through and triggers random samples. The libraries that I am using for the strings have one sample for high velocity, one for mid, and one for low. So it kind of hammers on those same three potential pitches, three potential recordings from that instrument over and over and over again. So it's difficult to get it to sound realistic. So that's a challenge. If you notice right here in bar four of our mockup, the cello splits to divisi. So the section actually splits up, and half of them play the top note and half of them play the bottom note. So this brings me to a really important point. When you are mocking up your score, anytime you're using a MIDI piano keyboard to play an instrument, you have to just be very careful to not do anything that particular instrument can't do. So like these close voiced triads cannot be played on a cello. Really anything less than like a fifth or like a minor sixth is a difficult interval to play on a cello. So that's why it splits this up into divisi. Now I could take my cello section sound and just hammer right through that and play those as chords with the full section, but that won't be the most realistic thing. So what I did to get a divisi feel is I used two different string section libraries, and I have them playing in unison here, and then I actually have one of them take the high road and one take the low road, so they split up as if they're different players. So on the unison notes, we've got the full power of the two section sounds, and then it splits up, and it's a little more realistic, I think. So we'll take a look at that. There's some other challenges here, but we'll work through those. Okay, let me go into the score since it opened up here. And what we're going to look at are track stacks. By the way, you can see very clearly that I'm using Logic Pro 10 here. though Digital Performer, Pro Tools, Cubase, Ableton Live, there's tons of great DAWs out there for doing MIDI mockups. I like Logic, but I don't even necessarily think that Logic is the best one out there. That's a bigger debate, but I used Logic for this particular mockup. So I'm going to look at Logic's track stack features. I've got my strings grouped into what's called a track stack, and these different DAWs have different functionality. You can generally group instruments in all those DAWs. I'm going to look at expression curves, which is a continuous controller. We'll get more into that. We'll look at some MIDI editing functionality. Well, let's just get into it. Let me play this for you. Here we go. Okay, there it is. There's the mockup. Let's see. Where do we want to start? I'll tell you what. Let me go back. Again, like I was saying, we're going to do this like a cooking show. Let me go back and open up the mockup before I went in and really cleaned up the MIDI and did all the stuff that I'm basically going to show you now. All right. Oh, I forgot to mention the libraries that I'm using. I have a Vienna Symphonic library, like a light edition of it. So I don't have the one that has all the great different articulations for up bow and down bow and all that stuff. But they sound really good. I'm also using some strings by Big Fish Audio. And that's pretty much it. All my woodwinds and horns are from Vienna Symphonic Library. My timpani is actually the stock timpani in Logic. And I actually think it's the orchestral percussion in Logic's orchestral library is pretty good. And then I've got different section sounds for, like you'll notice here, I've got violin 2A and violin 2B. And so my violin 2A is from Vienna Symphonic Library. Violin 2B is from Big Fish Audio. So like, well, just for example. That's the VSL violin. It's the Big Fish Audio violin. Let's focus on the low strings here. I'm going to solo these. Let's first focus actually just on cello. And let me cycle repeat this just for a couple of bars so that we can just hear this over and over and over again. Sounds terrible, right? So this is right after I played it in and quantized it, and that's pretty much it. So there's a lot of work to be done. And actually, let's just really do this organically. And I'm going to play in... I'm going to play that in again from scratch, just so we can totally do this process start to finish. Okay. There I've revealed exactly how good or not good my timing is. Let me play that back. And again, it sounds terrible, so we're going to clean that up. Now, I would recommend that you at least do your best to play everything in, and that can be really challenging with transposed instruments. If you get a MIDI keyboard that lets you transpose by chromatic steps, that helps a lot, because then you could, like, say, for example, with B-flat clarinet, you could play it written in the key of D, but have it sounding in the key of C, like it's supposed to. So I have a little MIDI keyboard that just lets me step up and down, not only by octave, but also by chromatic steps. So that's not a bad feature in a keyboard. All right. First off, now this brings us back to what I was talking about how a MIDI keyboard can do things that particular instruments can't do. And the flip side of that is MIDI keyboards can't do that. Do things that some instruments can do. And for example, playing a repeated note over and over and over again. If this was done on a cello, you could go up and down on each of those and have really hardly even a break at all between the notes. But on a MIDI keyboard, you have to release the key enough so that you can strike the key again. So there's going to be greater separation between the notes. So we have to account for that as well if we want this to sound like a cello. So let me highlight these. And quantize. And for those of you that don't know this term, quantizing is basically sobering up your players. It takes all your notes and it snaps them to a time grid. So I've got 16th note here, I hit quantize, you saw him move. And don't quantize to 100% because nobody can play with that good of timing. If you still want some soul in your piece, then quantize less. I like around 70%, but you know what that means is that it takes these notes and moves them 70% of the way towards the nearest 16th note. So it really cleans it up a lot, but it's not perfect. It's still human. Cool. Next thing I'm going to do, stretch them out. All right. Now, if I just left it like this, I'd have a problem because I have my MIDI off point overlapping with MIDI on with all these notes, and I could get notes dropping in and out because of that. Like, for example, this note might end where this note does because it gets the MIDI off message to end on that pitch. So I'm not done yet. I want to select all those. Logic has this cool function called trim note to remove overlaps. And I want to shorten these. Okay, great. Now it gives me a little bit of space between the notes too, but you'll notice that that now they're not overlapping anymore. So let me play this back again. Now that's a little better. Let me undo a couple steps. Oh, too far, too far. This is how it was before. And a little better, a little better. Now what I want to do is introduce another articulation sound. So I've got arco cello playing. I'm going to bring in a staccato cello sound as well. And what I'm going to do is just duplicate that track. And I will load up the same instrument library, but I'll instead call up a cello staccato right here. Okay. That's what the EXS24 sounds like before you load up an instrument. It's just a sine wave. Still loading. Has to wake up my hard drive. There's my staccato sound versus the arco or legato samples. And here's what I'll do. I'm going to copy this down here so that they are both playing. And actually, I'm also going to relabel this. This is cello staccato. This is actually cello A staccato. And this is cello A legato or arco or sus or whatever you want to call it. Now, I don't want to leave it like this because I don't want them both playing at the same time. We could hear what that sounds like. The staccato one's a little overbearing, but I'm going to select the notes that I want to be staccato and the ones that I want to be legato and delete them. So I'm just leaving the legato notes, and now we'll go in here and do the opposite. And now when I highlight both of these regions together, I can see them both, but let's take a listen to that. Okay, not there yet. We got some work to do still to get them to at least sound like they're coming from the same cello. Next thing we'll do is go in and tweak the velocities. So let me call up the velocity tool. And actually, I'm going to just do a blanket change to all of the staccato notes. I'm going to change the legato ones as well. So once I drop down to a velocity of under 85, it triggers the medium dynamic sample. You heard that change. Or under 90, I guess. Those need to be louder. Tedious? No, not at all. That's exactly why A-list composers have so many assistants to do all of this crap. Okay, it's better. You gotta massage it. You gotta take the time to get it to sound, I don't know, as realistic as possible. There are certainly other things that we could do. So we've looked at using our different articulation sounds within the library. Let's bring in our second library section sound. So this is the Big Fish Audio cello samples. And I could take the time to go in and do the same thing. Actually, this has some Marcato samples that might work really well. So let me duplicate and load up those cello Marcato samples. And Marcato is a little different than staccato, because staccato really is just a short note. A marcato bow stroke is a really quick, rough bow stroke. But that could do the trick. Now I'm going to cheat and slice this, scrap that, take those, copy them down here. Logic has some cool shortcuts. This is cello B legato. Cello B. It's really marcato, not staccato. And I select these regions. Option shift N. And boom, the region name changed to the track name, even though I just copied it from here. And I can do the same for these. That changed. So that's kind of nice. So let's listen to that. Okay, so we're getting there. It at least sounds full and punchy. Whereas before, let me play a couple of measures from beyond this. Yeah, the articulations were all over the place. The strong notes were not in the right place, and it just sounded kind of sloppy. Okay, so we're using string sounds from different libraries. We're using some different articulation sounds. We went in and looked at some MIDI editing tips. Let's now look at continuous controllers. And a continuous controller is a MIDI control over a parameter. And it could be panning. It could be volume. It could be vibrato, pitch bend, stuff like that. One that you can really get a lot of mileage out of is expression. Expression is continuous controller number 11. Volume is 7, panning is 10, and expression is 11. And expression is your control over your dynamics. And for string sounds, for any instrument that can start quiet and get louder, like any string or brass or woodwinds, basically any instrument other than percussion, expression helps a lot to sort of shape the curve. When you have things like your snare drum or a piano or a timpani, those can only start as loud as they're going to be and then get quieter. Whereas with a violin, you can start a note quietly and then apply more bow pressure and have the note gradually get louder. And expression helps you do that kind of stuff. It's different than volume. Volume actually is strict control over the volume slider of the track. Expression changes dynamics. Let me focus just on, well, I am going to bring in my track stacks. So track stacks in Logic are a great way for track management. What you can do is get a subgrouping of tracks by creating a track stack here. Shift Command D is the keyboard shortcut. And I'm going to create a summing stack for these cellos. And what a summing stack does is it allows me to put an effect on a track and have it apply to all of them. So I could EQ all of the cellos very easily with a track stack. I could also set up a send assignment. I could take all of these cellos and send some of their volume signal maybe out through bus one to go to reverb or something like that. And I could also control the volume of all the cellos with one slider. So a summing stack is awesome for that. And it does a couple other cool things that I'll show you here in a moment. So I'll create that, and it named it cellos. That's cool. That'll work. What I'm going to do is draw my expression on this track, and it's actually going to control all of the, it's going to send that expression curve to all of the cello instruments. Now, the biggest challenge with this in Logic is that I can go in and draw expression, but I don't see the notes here. So really what I want to do, there's kind of a workaround for that. I'm going to draw it in on this region and then do like a copy and paste thing. You'll see. It's going to be fantastic. I really want to emphasize the downbeat of the measure. So what I'm going to do is this rolling kind of start high, come down low, and I'm going to really exaggerate it. These notes aren't held out. If that was one note that was held out, it would sound kind of funny, but really these notes are just going to be as loud as whatever the expression point is where that note started. You'll hear it in a second. So that's all well and good for this cello sound because that's where I mapped it. So now what I'm going to do, I want that to control all the cellos. So I'm going to copy and paste this up here. Delete these notes. So let me make sure I've got the right region. I'm going to delete these notes, not the expression curve, just the notes. And then I'll go to this region and delete the expression curve that I just drew in. Hope that makes sense, but I've got the notes here now on the cello sound, the cello track. And I've got the expression curve on the summing track stack that I just created. So now it's going to send that expression curve to all of them. So let's listen to that. So much more realistic. Now, when in a MIDI mockup, whenever you have one instrument exposed, I mean, we're listening to just the cellos, and you can tell that it's MIDI, especially because we're looking at it and kind of we've walked through this process to clean it up like this. But when it's mixed in with everything, it's not going to be as exposed. So that's just one thing to keep in mind. Now, the basses. Sound like garbage as well because I haven't cleaned those up yet. So I am going to cheat on those two because why not? Let me, all right, here's what I did. I copied the cello down here. The basses are playing an octave lower than the cello. So boom, there they are. And copy this here. You know what? Actually, I noticed with this Big Fish audio library, it mapped those samples an octave higher. So for the Big Fish audio library, I play D2 and I hear it. And on the Vienna Symphonic library, I play D1, same pitch. So I mapped it the way that instrument notation transposes. Anyway, change the name of those. And let's create a summing track stack for the basses. I called them CBs, contrabasses. I'm going to call them basses. And I'll copy and paste this expression curve as well. And let's listen to all my low end strings. And I can just solo those two track stacks, and I got them all. Okay, cool. Now, what I love about this is I've got this kind of rolling wave thing here for this pirate theme that just works out well, I think. So, okay, we've looked at articulations, MIDI editing, continuous controllers, track stacks. One thing I neglected to mention at the beginning was creating a template. Now, it took me a while just to go in and create these tracks and name them and get them set up correctly, especially with all the instrument libraries and all of that. Now, when you guys are big and famous, you can bring in some underling to do that stuff for you. But while you have to do all that stuff yourself, save yourself some time. Oops, when did I erase those? Oh, wait a minute. Oh, what have I done? Undo. It doesn't matter. I'm not going to save this anyway. Create a template for yourself. And in Logic, you just create tracks and you go here to the file menu and you say save as template. And I'm sure other DAWs have a similar kind of a function. If they don't, what you can do is create a file and sort of create your own template library and go in and open up that file. It will load those tracks. When you do that, you want to immediately do save as and save it as another file so that you preserve your template file. But you can do this manually if the DAW that you use doesn't have any kind of template support like that. But I could go in and call this full orchestral mockup, which I actually did earlier, but I'm going to overwrite that one. And hit save. And then when I go to create a new Logic project, I can go to my templates and I've got it here, full orchestral mockup. Now it actually has the MIDI regions in there as well. So it saved that template exactly the way that I had it. So I would probably want to go in and delete those MIDI regions or create your tracks and then save the template before you go in and add everything. Anyway, that can be extraordinarily helpful, especially if you're working on several cues throughout a movie that have the same instrumentation. All right, now we want to look at some key switch and multi-output instruments. So I am going to bounce back to the mixed piece. Actually, before we do that, this technique with drawing an expression is really valuable. So I want to show this on the other strings as well, just to really hammer this point home. We've got this melody here. Let me go to the section where it really opens up, and we've got the soaring strings and octaves, and I want to hear just my violins. All right. Now they sound all right. Now, one problem that I have with this right now, I haven't gone in and scrubbed up the MIDI very much. You can hear every single attack on every single note. They really don't sound very legato. And it sounds like all my violinists are downbowing every single one of those notes. And it doesn't sound realistic. So I'm going to play this back again. Take a listen. You can hear distinctly the attack of every single note, and it's not very legato. So here is what I'm going to do. I am going to take those notes. And I'm going to stretch them out so they're longer. And I'm going to have them overlap just a touch. Now, the only reason that you can get away with this is because it's a section sound. If this was one solo individual clarinet, then this would sound really bad because a clarinet can't do that. You can't have this note continue on when you bring in this note. And actually, really, one solo violin can't do that. But because it's a section sound, the different string players are going to hold the notes out a little bit longer than others. Plus, also, this is going through some rather large reverb sound, so it kind of washes it out anyway. But this really helps blur the attack of the next note. Now, again, if you have a really high-end sample library, it'll have up bow strokes, and you would have note one be down bow and then up bow, and it can get extraordinarily tedious, but would sound very realistic. But I think helps. So let me play it back. Whoa. These notes are a 16th note off. Wow. Didn't notice that before. And actually, in the score, there's a rest here, so there's got to be a little bit of breathing room between those notes. So let me play this back again. Okay. Now I'm going to sum those and draw some expression in, and let's hear how well it sounds after that. Now I'm just going to kind of follow the shape of the phrasing. When we get to that high note, that's really when we're sort of at the peak of that phrase. And I'm just going to kind of actually follow the shape of the melody. And now, again, I don't want the expression on this track. I want it on the summed track. So I will delete the expression on the track that I just drew in, and I will delete the notes on this region. So this region right now is only the expression curve, and it will be sending that signal to all of the violins. Now this really is kind of cheating. If you want a very realistic sound, you should do a separate expression curve on each of your string parts, because they're going to play it a little bit differently, and that will help you create just a little bit of nuance that will give it just the right amount of that kind of chaos element to make it sound human. But this will help immensely compared to what we just heard a moment ago. So let me play this. So again, here it is without the expression. And with the expression. Okay, so again, it's really tedious getting this to sound realistic, and I would want to spend more time with that, scrubbing it up to get it to sound really good. But those steps help immensely. And I can't stress enough how much expression helps. So now let's take a look at track stacks. Not track stacks, but key switch and multi-output instruments. My favorite nerdy term that MIDI composers use is instantiate. Whenever you create a software virtual instrument, you create an instance of it. And another way to say that is you instantiate. So if I were instructing you guys, I would say, okay, now go ahead and instantiate contact, which is just totally nerdy, but is a term that you will probably hear. But I'm going to go ahead and instantiate contact. Contact is a virtual instrument that allows for 16 MIDI inputs and 16 separate discrete stereo audio outputs. So you can have one instance of contact and have 16 instruments in that one contact instance. Now, that saves a lot on your computer processing power. So that's kind of the reasoning behind it. And it also just kind of helps you organize stuff. I have a horn library, also from Big Fish Audio, called First Call Horns, that I think is pretty good. It was $160. And it's got trumpets, French horns, and trombones. It's also got a full sax section, so I've used it for big band stuff before. And the articulations are nice, and it sounds good. It sounds solid. And so I'm going to use it for all my trumpets, French horns, and trombones. So right now these are in Vienna Symphonic Library, and I'm going to swap them out. So what I'm going to do is create an instance of contact, multi-timbral, or multi-timbral, however you like to pronounce that, and with 10 separate MIDI channels. So I've got 3 trumpets, 4 horns, 3 trombones. 3 plus 4, 4 plus 3 is 10. So 10 instruments. And I hit create, and what it will do is give me 10 tracks that are all routed to the same place. So these are really all the same software instrument track. But if you look up here in the top left, instrument track 1 is going to MIDI channel 1, and track 2 to MIDI channel 2, and I'm just cycling down through them. So they're all instrument 1, but MIDI channel 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So that's very cool. Now, I apologize because this is kind of boring, but I need to name these, otherwise I'll get super confused. So trumpet 1, I'll try to do this fast, trumpet 2, trumpet 3, and then horn 1, 2, 3, and 4, and then we've got trombone 1, 2, and 3. Okay. Now, I will take my MIDI regions for the 3 trombones, drag them down. Oh, that's obnoxious. Let me make this smaller first. All right. And the horns and the trumpets. Now I've got I can't talk and move tracks at the same time. All right. Now I've got the expression curves on those summing stacks, so I'm going to leave those alone. And I'll also now mute those, even though there's not really anything to mute. And let's solo these. And it solos them all and mutes them all together because they are the same instrument track. So that actually is a little bit problematic. If you want to have a different volume or different panning or different mute and solo things, you need to create auxiliary channels for each of those. So we're not totally there yet. But I will now instantiate contact. And I want an instance of contact that has 16 separate stereo outputs. Okay. And now I will load up my instruments. Now what would be ideal is if you had a separately sampled instrument for your different horn players. So this is another case for using different instrument libraries. There are times when my trumpet 2 and 3 player play in unison. So if I use the exact same instrument, then it's going to trigger the same sample and I might get some weird phasing issues. So ideally, I would use my Vienna Symphonic Library trumpet for one, and I could even use the Logic trumpet for another one, and then this trumpet for a third. And some library samples have different, they might even organize it by seat. It might be trumpet seat 1 and 2 and 3 and so on. So anyway, now I want my horns. And I've got a French horn key switch instrument. I want to talk about that. And then I'm going to use the solo no vibrato one for the others. How many did I create? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. And now trombones. Now you'll notice that I have a trombone section sound I have solo instrument and a section instrument for just about everything. So that's cool. I could use the section sounds, but that's good if you have a bunch of players playing in unison. If you want to cut corners and do things fast and kind of sloppy, you could just use a section sound for each instrument and just sequence all the parts on the one section sound. But it's really not the most realistic way to interpret the music. So, you know, if your mock-up is really just going to be a rough draft, that's fine. But if the mock-up is going to be the final product, or if you're giving the mock-up to a director that has a hard time listening to it and imagining what it's actually going to sound like when it's recorded by real live players, then you want it to sound as good as possible. And this is really the way to do it, using solo instrumentalists. okay, now I have no expression curve going on all these, and they're all kind of at full volume. Let me actually turn that track down a little bit. This turns them all down, and they're all panned dead center. So, let's just hear how it sounds. Let me go to a point where they all come in together. Oof, abrasive, just as I thought. Let me turn that down a little bit more. Okay, so you know what we need to do. We need to go in and edit note velocity. We might even want to use different articulations. We definitely need expression curves on all this, so I'm not going to go through that again, but I do want to go over how you deal with a multi-output instrument, because right now I have half of this done. I've got all my instruments on different tracks, all going to this one instance of contact. But here's the challenge. I go into trumpet one and I adjust the volume and I adjust the panning, and I go to trumpet two and it's the same thing. So, oh, I don't want that. I move the panning back, move the volume back, go back to trumpet one, and it's reset that back again. So they're all using the same audio channel object. So, here's what I do. I open up contact, and I open up contact's output mixer. And in here, there's an option under batch functions called clear output section and create one individual channel for each loaded instrument. That is like a long ass name for one command, but that's what it does. It gives you a separate discrete audio output for each of your instruments loaded into this one instance. So boom, there it is. And it's labeled trumpet one, trumpet two. Well, it says trumpet open, but it's trumpet one, two, three, French horn, one, two, three, four, and so on. And these are routed to contact output one, two, three, four. So these are stereo outputs, five, six, and so on up to 1920. Great. That is fantastic. Now I have separate audio outputs for each of those. The next step is in my mixer, I need to create auxiliary channels to capture those audio outputs, because right now those audio outputs are assigned separately. But I need to capture them separately. So here is my contact instrument track. And because I created an instance of contact that has multiple outputs, I've got this plus and minus button here on the track. Anytime you create an instrument with multiple outputs, it'll give you this. I hit this button, it creates an auxiliary channel strip that is automatically receiving audio from contact 3, 4. And so I keep doing that for all my instruments. Now, trumpet 1 is outputting through 1 and 2, which is actually going to still be on this instrument 1 track. But now I've got trumpet 1, 2, 3, horn 1, 2, 3, 4. I need two more. And again, I have to label these or it's going to get really confusing. So bear with me. trumpet one, two. So there's good and bad about this. The good is that it saves computer CPU and it works a lot more efficiently. The bad is that you have to have two separate tracks for each instrument. I have my MIDI track up here, and now I have to have an auxiliary track where I go in and adjust the volume and panning and add effects for each of those. But it's just the way it is. Just the way it is. Trombone one, two, three. And oh my God, sorry. Oh, I had a funny feeling that was gonna happen. Now I have separate solo and muting capabilities and volume and panning changes. Okay, so I could bring in the trumpets. Ouch. And I could pan them out. And just real quick with panning, one school of thought is to pan them according to their orchestral seating chart. And that's a great way to do it. It's not the only way, but it's a good way to do it. So I'm going to put these, actually the, horns would kind of be over on the right side. You could do a Google image search for an orchestral seating chart and just follow that for your panning. And that's totally valid, but I could pan these out. Now two and three are, doubling each other. So they're playing the same sample. So it sounds a little weird, but at any rate, that's how you deal with multi-output instruments. Now what I want to do is look at a key switch instrument. I love the French horn. It's so majestic sounding. Okay, so I loaded one key switch instrument in this contact instance here, and it's for horn one, and a key switch instrument has these things down here, these little red keys, and what it does is it loads up a bunch of different sample sets, and one sample set is just regular notes. Another sample set, well, let's hear them. That track selected, okay. Okay, so those are the regular samples, and now if I trigger this note, it's muted samples. And with the French horn, the way you mute it is you actually just jam your whole fist right into the bell of the instrument. Keep playing the wrong note there. Then if I play this, it's staccato notes. And then this is glissando, which is very cool. I don't really have any use for it in this cue, but that's kind of nice. Sounds a little weird in harmony, but so what you do is actually put a note down here to change to those different articulations. So let's check out how you would do that. In horn one, I'm going to have these two notes play staccato. So the key switch MIDI pitch for staccato for this particular instrument is E0, way down here. The way that key switch instruments typically work, so I put that on the wrong note, they are usually the first full octave below, outside the range of the instrument. That's how contact sets it up anyway. And I want this note to actually start before these pitches here. And then I can have it come back to, I can copy and paste this, and C0 will give me my regular legato horn sounds, like that. So I go to, now if this wasn't there, these would play legato. Like that, but with that key switch sample, or that key switch trigger. So I could, just for the hell of it, use that glissando sample as well. Not long enough to get the full glissando sample in there. And then I could go back to staccato. So I think you can see the benefit of that. You don't have multiple, you don't have to have multiple tracks for every single articulation code. So key switch instruments are fantastic for that. Also, a lot of times the key switch instrument has it built in here. Well, it tells me what MIDI pitch and what that articulation is. Sometimes your key switch instruments have buttons in there that you can actually hit record and play, and you can just click on those and it'll basically automate switches between them without actually having to put in the MIDI note, so that's kind of helpful. One challenge with this is going to wreak havoc on your notation. If you need to use this to print notation for your player as well, this is going to look like garbage. It's going to be tons of ledger lines below the staff, and they're going to be like, what am I supposed to do with those notes? Because they're obviously out of the range of that instrument. So this is where track stacks come in nicely. You could, if all your horns are the same key switches, you could group them all together, do a summing track stack, and put the key switches on that summed track. Now, I want to do the same thing that I did before with my expression, where I delete the key switches here, and I delete everything but the key switches here. So now my notation for this track is preserved. Whereas here, it looks like garbage. Yet I still get the same effect. And I muted them. Okay. All right, I actually don't want to hear these other ones. So let me mute those regions, because for those, I did not use the key switch instrument. So those key switches aren't going to do a damn thing. All right. I think I might need to give it a little more pre-roll. Oh boy. I've got another instrument soloed in here. There it is. I had this soloed. Anyway, I think you get the idea. So, that's everything I wanted to talk about. Now, there's more here. I mean, as far as mixing for orchestra, that's a whole separate topic that we could get into. And perhaps I'll put together another webinar on that, because there's a lot of stuff going on in this mix here that we could cover. But hopefully this gives you guys some tips to get set up for your own MIDI orchestral mockups. Now, we have a lot of stuff going on at Seawolf Studio, so let me jump over here and run through some of this stuff real quick. As a thank you for attending this webinar, we're going to give you guys 20% off on some of our upcoming courses. Starting on Monday next week, we've got The Art of Film Scoring. This is our flagship course, 6 weeks long, starts November 11th. It's normally $249, but with the 20% off, it's $199. In that class, we cover film music history, thematic analysis, music theory and composition techniques. We cover technical aspects of film scoring, self-promotion tips for film composers. By the end of that course, you will have scored 2 demo pieces. In addition to that, we have our MIDI Mockups course on orchestral instrumentation. This is also 6 weeks, also starts November 11th, and $199 with the discount. We go over key composers of Western music history, evolution of the orchestra. We explore orchestral families and instruments. We do a lot of orchestral score analysis. And by the end of that class, you will have scored a full orchestral MIDI mockup. And I'm very excited about this. For our spring semester in 2014, we're offering Game Audio Essentials, which is also 6 weeks, starts January 27th. This course is $239 with a discount. We'll go over the evolution of game audio, scoring and sound design for games, audio implementation into a game engine, self-promotion workshop, and through that course, you'll compose your own game music and you'll create your own game sound effects. So that one's going to be a lot of fun. You can save 20% on all of these courses with the promo code Seawolf Online, SEAWOLF Online. And you can register for these at seawolfstudios.net. Spots are limited. Register now. These classes are going to be a lot of fun. They'll really help boost your music career. And anyway, thank you for your time tonight. I hope that you have some tips that you can take away from this. It certainly has been fun for me to go over this stuff. And I hope to hear some of your MIDI mockups down the road. Send them my way. You guys can ask me follow-up questions or send your MIDI mockups my way at chris@seawolfstudios.net. Take care and have a great night. Thank you.